اصطفى آدم ونوحا وآل إبراهيم وآل عمران على العالمين صلوات من إبراهيم. Like to extend the best wishes on this very important day and the event that we are celebrating, the birth anniversary of the Lady of Light, Fatimatu Zahra, salawatullah alayha. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless you for showing up in this celebration of the Bibi's Viladat in this very extreme weather. Although we should also thank the sponsors, that has an element, but you know, even in Da'wat Zul Ashira, Rasulullah first served food before delivering the message. So we are following that sunnah. Salawat Pandik Parah. Bibi Fāṭimatu Zahra is basically the nucleus of Ahl-e Kisā. When you hear the event of Kisā, the mantle, the five holy figures, if there is anyone among the five of them who was directly related to each of others there, it was only Fāṭimatu Zahra. Ali was related to Rasulullah through his father. Hassan and Hussein are related to Rasulullah through their mother. It was only Fatima who is there in the middle. She is directly the daughter of the Prophet. She is directly related to Ali as the wife. And she is directly related to Hassan and Hussein as the mother. And so she becomes basically that markaz, the nucleus and the center of the Ahlul Bayt. And keeping that in mind, this importance of family, I would like to briefly tonight again emphasize a point when it comes to our family life. We've talked about it in different gatherings in different ways. But tonight I would like to again go back to this issue of family life, keeping in mind that we are actually followers of the Ahlul Bayt. What does Ahlul Bayt mean? Ahlul Bayt means the household of the members of the household of the Prophet, the family of the Prophet. Our mazhab, our path in Islam is the path of the family. And so for us, when we talk about family life, this is a very, not only an important issue, but it's also linked to our own identity. When you look at the family life in Islam, you know, there are two famous family models. One is what is known as the extended family or the joint family system, where you have two, three generations with their, children all under the same roof. Or you have the modern Western system, which is known as the nuclear family or the separate family system, where it's only the couple and their children living separately. Islam doesn't go on this side or that side. Islam has its own perspective right in the middle. And just to simplify it, I will say, you know, Islam basically prefers what is known as the semi-attached family system. I'm using this term from the real estate industry. We can say semi-detached, but no, let me be positive. Semi-attached. So there is separation, but there is also attachment. And this is what Islam basically talks about. So, and you know, the nuclear family system is a model that Islam would prefer, with great emphasis on what is known as Ṣilatu r-raḥam. What is Ṣilatu r-raḥam? Ṣilatu r-raḥam means, you know, making the close ones, you know, the ties of relationship more closer and stronger. Maintaining the ties of relationship with all its commitments, kindness and helping one another, be concerning, a concern for one another. And so we see that, for example, if you look at the extended family system, you know, they are all under the same roof. Two, three, four generations. But their hearts are not united. They are divided. Because of also the way the lifestyle is in the joint family system. When you come to the purely nuclear family system, you know, in the Western style, then you will see that, you know, their households are separate, even their hearts are separate. Mother's Day, yeah, Salaam Alaikum, how are you? Father's Day, a phone call. You know, but that attachment is not that there on that level. And this is where Islam says that you can have your household separate, but your heart should be all united and together. And when we look at this issue, this is actually a very serious issue even in the modern society. Just in the recent magazine, one of the prominent American intellectuals by the name of David Brooks, he's written a very interesting article, a very extended article on the history of family system in America. And the title is very interesting. It says, "The Nuclear Family Was a Mistake." And he actually starts his article by looking at a review of the 1991 film Avalon, which actually traces how, for example, an Italian family came to America. So you have the grandparents, their children, then their children, all living, you know, together. Gradually, they started, you know, separating from one another. And in this process, you know, David Brooks even interviewed the producer of that film, Barry Levinson. And the quotation that he has is actually summarizes the problem in the modern American or Western society. And he says, "In my childhood, you would gather around the grandparents and they would tell the family stories. Now individuals sit around the TV watching other family stories, which are not even true, most of them." And then basically he's talking about, you know, the whole film is based on this, showing the decentralization of the family in American society. And he says, "Once families at least gathered around the television, now each person has his own screen. Even when husband and wife don't go to the bed, you know, she has her screen, he has his screen." And so this issue of, you know, having a family which is linked to one another, you know, sometimes we see we are very advanced, you know, mashallah, everybody has their own gadgets. We do not realize that we are actually missing out in what is known as the human touch. There was a time, for example, if you wanted to call your son who is in his bedroom, you will call the other one, go and call him. Either go or go down to the hallway and shout, "Come down." Now you tell him, he'll just do it. Huh? So there's no issue of talking to one another. You know, that human element is going away. The human touch is going away. And so Islam basically promotes a middle path, nuclear family model with a strong emphasis on Ṣilatu rahm, maintaining the ties of those who are related to you. Because if you don't maintain that, you know, the ties, then what happens to the family, nuclear family? You know, gradually self-centeredness or hyper-individualism comes in. And when that comes in, then there is de-linking of the nuclear family, you know, with those who are related to them. And when I use the word de-linking here, this is opposite of Ṣilatu rahm. It is known as qata'u rahm, which means severing the ties with those who are related to you. In Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about Ṣilatu rahm more than he talks about namaz. In Quran, Allah condemns qita'u rahm more than any other things there. And this is where we have to realize, you know, just one example. In Surah An-Nur, Surah number 24, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in ayat 21 gives an indication of a nuclear family with strong sense of Ṣilatu r-Raḥam. And this is an ayat where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, you know, that what are the houses where you can go and eat food there without waiting for invitation or without asking permission? I might be saying something very dangerous here, but you'll learn about it. List of houses where you can go without invitation. And remember, Quran doesn't talk about how to do the namaz. The command of salat is there in Quran, but it doesn't tell you stand up, do takbir, say this surah, then go to ruku, then get up and say this and go into sajda, and this is how you should do sajda. How many rakat are there? There is nothing there. When it comes to this family life, especially maintaining this concept of nuclear family with this strong sense of Ṣilatu r-Raḥam, you have an ayat there where you are told, Laysa haraj. An ayat goes on, Wala ala anfusikum an ta'kulu. There is no problem on you if you eat from following houses. There are 11 houses listed here. Number one, buyutikum, your house. Of course, it's a given. But Allah just wants to make sure everything is there. So he starts with your own house. Number two, abuyut abaikum, your father's house. Buyut ummahatikum, your mother's house. Aw buyut akhwanikum, your brother's house. Aw buyut akhawatikum, your sister's home. Aw buyut a'mamikum, your uncle's home. Aw buyut ammatikum, your aunt's house. Aw buyut akhwalikum, your uncle from the mother's side, mamu, your mama's house. Aw buyut khalatikum, your aunt from the mother's side, her house. Aw ma malaktum mafatihu, or a house whose keys has been given to you temporarily. A friend of you or somebody who is going on vacation, he says, you know, can you take care of my house? You know, go there once day, once in a day, or once in a week. You go in there, you are thirsty or hungry, open the fridge and you see some there is food is there. Do you have to call your friend on vacation? Can I eat this? No, this ayat says you can eat. Because you have the keys to the house, but only the fridge, not anywhere else. The issue is about eating. And 11th, last one, aw sadiqukum, your friend's home. But then you have to figure out who is a friend. The word sadiq in Arabic, probably there is a related to this issue of sidq. Somebody whom you consider to be a true friend. Not somebody who says, Assalamu alaikum, in masjid only. No. So this is where we see, you know, if you look at this list here, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is basically giving us the list of 8 relatives whose houses are separate from one another. Your house, your father's home. Your house, your mother's home. Your house, your brother's home. Your sister, your uncles, your aunts. It means that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying there is no problem if you have separate homes. But then what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does in this ayat is that he's taking away the formality in visiting and maintaining this relationship between one another. You can go there without any, you know, formality. Of course, you know, it's part of good manners to give a call at least that I'm coming. Otherwise, you might, you know, go all the way there and see nobody's there. Or if you come unannounced, don't expect biryani. You might just get chai and biscuit. And so Ṣilatu r-Raḥam works both ways. Means those who are related to you should be welcoming, even if you come in unannounced. And Ṣilatu rahm on your part would be that you don't expect, you know, special, service there at that time. Formalities there are then gone. And this is where we see that the importance of maintaining this relationship is very important in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Salawat upon the Ikbarar. Just a way of, you know, emphasizing on this point of maintaining the ties with those who are related to you. For example, if you give charity, sadaqah, what is the number of reward you get? Allah in the Quran has promised, whatever good thing you do, I'll multiply the reward 10 times. Man ja'a bil hasana, whoever comes with a good deed, I will reward him 10 times. So you give in charity, Allah will reward you 10 times. Something even about sadaqah is when you give a loan, interest-free loan, to somebody who needs that. That is valued even more than, you know, sadaqah and charity. And the reward for that would be 18 times, not 10 times. When you help your brethren in faith, there the reward would be 20 times. But when you maintain Ṣilatu rahm, you maintain the ties with those who are related to you, the reward is multiplied 24 times. And this is how the Prophet is saying that, you know, you have to realize Ṣilatu rahm is considered to be a very important issue in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Even our Bibi Fāṭimatu z-Zahrā, salawatullah alayha, in a segment in Khutbah Fadakiyya, where she has a section where she talks about the rationale behind some of the commandments of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, she says, وَصِلَةُ الْأَرْحَامِ مَنْ سَأَتًا فِي الْعُمْرِ وَمَنْ مَاتًا لِلْعَدَدْ. She says, maintaining your ties with those who are related to you, number one, it prolongs your life. Maybe Malakul Maut was given, you know, the information that so-and-so will live for 40 years, but then there was a provision there. Unless he does Ṣilatu rahm, then he will be living for 60 years. So the life can prolong, you know, based on Ṣilatu rahm. And even the number of, you know, family members and the increase in blessing is also part of the reward in the words of Fatimatu Zahra, salawatullah, salawat upon Ikbar. Even in her life, after the marriage with Amir al-Mu'mineen, they didn't live in the house of the Prophet. They had their separate house, of course, which was next door to Rasulullah. But even then, although their houses were separate, but their Ṣilatu rahm, that, you know, exercising this maintaining of the ties, was very frequent and very obvious for us in history when you look at the example. You know, the famous story that we recite, Hadith-e Kisā. Hadith-e Kisā is actually the example of how to maintain your ties. I am not sure about the context of the beginning of the story there in Hadith-e Kisā, whether the Prophet had come from a journey or he was in town. But right in the beginning, you know, the Prophet comes in, and what does he say? Inni ajidu fi badani dhu'fan. You know, I feel weakness, or I'm tired. Ya Rasulullah, if you're tired, mashallah, Allah has given you so many wives. And you live just next door. At least some of them were considerate and very, you know, obedient to Rasulullah. They used to serve him you know, willingly, out of their own love for him. But Rasulullah decides not to go to his home. He goes next door to the house of his daughter. It's not that he sends somebody, you know, going to ask Ali, am I allowed to come now? You know, because now you are the in charge of that house. No. He comes in. There was nobody there other than Fatima. And he says, you know, inni ajidu fi badani dhu'fan. Lies down. Bibi Fatima Zahra comes in. And basically, this is where we see that, you know, فَعَتَيْتُهُ, where she says, that I came to him بِالْكَسَىٰ الْيَمَانِ فَغَتَّيْتُهُ بِهِ. And I covered him with that, you know, kisa, the mantle. And then you see this expression of Ṣilatu rahm, not only between the father and the daughter. The grandsons come, one after another. Look at the akhlaq that we see there, or the wordings which have been used. Ya amma, because now Rasulullah was covered fully. They couldn't see him. But both of them, at their own times, when they came in, they say, Ya amma, inni ashummu indaki rahiyatan tayyiba, ka'annaha rahiyatu jaddi Rasulullah. That, oh, my mother, you know, it seems that I'm able to sense the fragrance of the scent of my of a very good one, which looks like the scent of my grandfather. I can smell him. I can feel his presence. And this is where the mother says, yes, he is there under the kisa. And then, you know, Hassan goes underneath that. Hussein also goes in that kisa. And then Amir al-Mu'minin comes in. And finally, you know, Bibi Fatimah al-Zahra comes in and Rasulullah does the dua. And this is where the ayat of Tathir is revealed at that time. Salawat parne ek bar. And the point is that their houses were separate. But their hearts were united. And that is the example that we have to keep in mind whenever we do the recitation or we hear the hadith-i kisa. It's not only for sawab. This is the problem. Sometimes we say, okay, let's recite it, sawab milega. Especially the last dua at the end, you know, talks about the barakat of the malaika for those who are reciting and listening to that gathering, to the hadith-i kisa. Yes, this is good. But it is a constant, you know, message given to us in our mahfil, in our celebrations, in our marriage ceremonies, when Hadith-i Kisa is recited, that remember Hadith-i Kisa is a constant message of maintaining the ties that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created among us. Salawat upon the Akbar. And the beautiful words that Rasulullah uses there, when he prays for them, he says, Allahumma haulai ahlu bayti wa khasati. That, O Allah, they are my ahl bayt, my family, my dear ones. Lahmuhum lahmi. Their flesh is my flesh. Damuhum dami. Their blood is my blood. Yu'limuni ma yu'limuhum. Whatever hurts them hurts me. وَيُحْزُنُنَ مَا يَحْزُنُهُمْ, and whatever, you know, makes them sad, makes me also sad. This was a message for the Ummah at that time. That when you deal with him, remember they are linked to me. If you hurt them, you are hurting me. If you please them, then you are pleasing me. And when you hurt me or please me, remember by extension, I am linked to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Even this ayah that you see on the, well, with the decoration here, but on the panel that we have on the wall there, from Surah Azab, it says, you know, those who hurt Allah and Rasul, how can we hurt Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? It means when you hurt Rasulullah, you are hurting, in a symbolic sense, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And now Rasul is linking his Ahlul Bayt to himself. And this is where we have to realize. And then he says, "Ana harbun liman harabahum." Whoever fights against them is actually, I will fight against them. وَسِلْمٌ لِمَنْ سَالَمَهُمْ Whoever makes peace with them, I will also make peace with that person. عَدُوٌ لِمَنْ عَادَاهُمْ I am enemy to those who are enemies of my Ahlul Bayt. وَمُحِبٌ لِمَنْ أَحَبَّهُمْ And I love those who love the Ahlul Bayt. Why? إِنَّهُمْ مِنِّي وَعَنَا مِنُهُمْ Because they are from me and I am from them. Salawat Pranayi Kbara. When we talk about the importance of Bibi Fatimah Zahra, let me share with you one Hadith Qudsi. Hadith Qudsi is actually the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but it's not part of the ayat of Quran. And this is narrated by the Prophet, and the Imams actually quote the Prophet on this issue. There is an interesting Hadith Qudsi which talks about the early days of the creation of Adam. And this is an issue we had talked about it before, but let me just, share with you this Hadith Qudsi. It talks about the greatness of this Lady of Light. And this is at the time where Adam has now been, he's alive now. He's been, his body was there, and then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put the soul on him. And this is before the question and answer between the malaika and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is actually before the contest, I would say, between Adam and the malaika. According to this narration, فَقَالَ Adam, يَا رَبِّ مَا هَذِهِ الْأَشْبَاحِ Adam looked at the Arsh of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Arsh means the throne. It doesn't mean Allah sits on it. No, this is just a symbolic, center of power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And around them, there were some spiritual forms, some lights. And Adam didn't know what is this. He is asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Ya Rabbi, ma hadhihi al-ashbah? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قال الله تعالى يا آدم هذه أشباه أفضل خلائقي وبرياتي. O Adam, these are the best of my creation. These are the spiritual form of those who are the best among my creation. And then he says, these five lights that you see, هذا محمدٌ. وعن المحمود الحميد في أفعالي شققت له اسما باسمي. He says, this is Muhammad, and I am Mahmud. Mahmud means the praiseworthy one. And I have actually derived his name from my name. I am Mahmud, so I call him Muhammad. وهذا علي, the second one. The second nur that you see is Ali. وعن العلي العظيم and I am the high, most high and the great شققت له اسما من اسمي I derive his name from my name he is علي I am علي العظيم وهذه فاطمة the third nur that you see Adam أنا فاطر السماوات والأرض. I am the one who created the heavens and the earth. And then he says, and then he ends by saying, فشققت لها اسما من اسمي. I am فاطر السماوات والأرض, and I derive her name from my name, and I called her Fatima. And what is the impact of this name Fatima? I'll come to it later on. So I bypass one sentence here. And then he says to Adam, these two other nurs that you see, وَحَاذَ الْحَسَنْ وَالْحُسَيْنِ وَعَنَ الْمُحْسِنِ You know, these are the anwar of the Noor and the light of Hassan and Hussein, and I am the Muhsin. I am the beneficent, and I derive their names from my name. And he ends by saying, هَؤُلَاءِ خِيَارُ خَلِيقَتِي وَكِرَامُ بَرِيَّتِي. You know, they are the best of my creation and the most honorable ones of my creation. بِهِمْ أَأَخُذُ. Through them I choose. وَبِهِمْ أُعْتِي. And through them I give. وَبِهِمْ أُعَاقِبُ. And through them I actually punish. وَبِهِمْ أُثِيب. And through them I reward the people. Salawat parne ek bar. Now even these names of the Panjatan comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Although what I've narrated to you is from the Shia sources, but even among Sunnis, you can look at As-Sawaiq al-Muhriqa of Ibn Hajar Makki, or even Khatib al-Baghdadi in his Tariq Baghdadi, they narrate from Abdullah ibn Abbas, where the Prophet actually talks about the name of Fatima. And what is the impact of that? So let me go back to the sentence that I left out. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to Adam, وَهَذَهِ فَاطِمَا وَعَنَا فَاطِرُ السَّمَوَاتِ وَالْعَرْضِ, then he says, why do I call her Fatima? فَاطِمُ أَعْدَائِي مِنْ رَحْمَتِي يَوْمَ فَصْلِ قَضَائِي. Fatim means somebody who is going to separate. He says, I named her as Fatim because she will separate my enemies on the day of judgment from my mercy. وَفَاطِمَ أَوْلِيَائِي أَمَّا يَغُمُّهُمْ وَيُسِيُّهُمْ. And on the day of Qiyamah, when it comes to those who follow me and those who love me, she will actually keep them away from whatever is going to be displeasing to those mu'mineen. So she is actually the source for mu'mineen of all, you know, keeping away all the difficulties and the displeasure of the day of Qiyamah. In the hadith that I was referring to, the Sunni sources, they actually have a hadith from Abdullah ibn Abbas where the Prophet says, Ibnati Fatima hawra'un adamiyya. Then my daughter Fatima, she is a human huri in a way. She is not just, you know, just an ordinary human being. وَإِنَّمَا سَمَّاهَا فَاطِمَا, and she has been named as Fatima, لِعَنَّ اللَّهَ فَطَمَهَا وَمُحِبِّيهَا عَنِ النَّارِ, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has kept her and those who love her from the fire of Jahannam. Salawat upon the Ikbal. Sayyida ka naam bhi khuda ka diya hua hai. اور خود اس نام میں وہ حقیقت ہے کہ اپنے دشمنوں کو رحمت الہی سے دور رکھیں گی اور اپنے چاہنے والوں کو تمام اذیت اور مصیبتوں سے دور رکھیں گی. اس لیے ہمارے لیے وہ وسیلہ ہے, ہمارے لیے وہ نجات ہے. یہ حدیث قدسی جو ہم نے انگریزی میں پڑھی ہے, اس کے بعد ایک اور کنکلوژن ہے اس کو جو ہم نے چھوڑ دیا تھا اردو کے لیے, جہاں خداوند عالم پھر آدم سے کہتے ہیں, فتوسل الی بہم یا آدم. اے آدم, اگر آپ کو کوئی مصیبت میں گرفتار اگر ہو جائے تو تم جو ہے ان کے ذریعے وسیلہ مانگنا مجھ سے, ان کو وسیلہ بنا کے مجھ تک پہنچنا. فجعلہم الی شفعاؤک, تم انہیں شفیع بناؤ جب تمہیں ضرورت پڑے. فَإِنِّي عَلَيْتُ عَلَى نَفْسِي قَسَمًا حَقًّا, اس لیے کہ میں نے قسم کھائی ہے, وہ قسم جو حق ہے, خدا کے ہر قسم حق ہے. لَا أُخَيُّبُ بِهِمْ عَامِلًا, اس لیے کہ جو ان کے ذریعے سے آئے گا اسے کبھی ہم مایوس نہیں کریں گے. وَلَا أَرُدُّ بِهِمْ سَائِلًا, وہ جو ان کے ذریعے مانگے گا ہم اس کے خواہش کو رد نہیں کریں گے. فَلِذَٰلِكَ هِينَ زَلَّتْ مِنْهُ الْخَطِيعَ دَعَ اللَّهُ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ بِهِمْ فَتَابَ عَلَيْهِ وَغَفَرَ لَهُ. In Surah Baqarah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, when this whole story of Adam, the fall of Adam as we call it, happened, which was a what we call tarka awla, was not a sin in the technical sense. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَتَلَقَّ عَدَمَ بِكَلِمَاتٍ. Allah taught some words to Adam and asked him, now pray to me with these words. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and then I accepted his prayers. What were those words? Those were the holy names of that Anwar that Adam had seen. Muhammad and Ali and Fatima and Hassan and Hussein alayhim as-salatu was-salam. تو ہمارے لیے کوئی پرابلم نہیں ہونا چاہیے کہ جب وسیلے کی بات ہوتی ہے خصوصاً جب ہم لوگ کبھی کبھی لوگ کہتے ہیں یہ شیعوں کا کیا ہو گیا ہے کبھی کبھی اپنی دعاؤں میں ہم کہتے ہیں اللہم انی اسألوک بفاطمہ وابیہ وبعلیہ وبنیہ اور آگے بات بڑھ جاتی ہے کہ خداوندہ ہم تجھ سے مانگ رہے ہیں تیری بارگاہ میں پہنچے ہیں فاطمہ کے ذریعے فاطمہ کے بابا کے ذریعے فاطمہ کے شوہر کے ذریعے فاطمہ کے بیٹوں کے ذریعے اور وہ امام جو ان کی نسل سے ہیں یہ جو ہے شرک کی بات نہیں ہو رہی ہے یہ ہمارے لیے شفاعت ہیں ہمارے لیے وسیلہ ہیں اور خداوند عالم نے جب ان کے نور کو سب سے پہلے خلق کیا تھا خود شیعہ سنی سب میں وہ مشہور حدیث ہے اول ما خلق اللہ نوری رسول نے کہا کہ سب سے پہلی چیز جو خدا نے خلق کی ہے وہ میرا نور تھا نوری لیول پر یہ لوگ موجود تھے پہلے انسانی لیول پر بشری لیول پر بعد میں آئے ہیں اور جب آدم کو ہی خداوند عالم نے کہا کہ ان کو وسیلہ بنانا تو یقیناً ہمارے لیے بھی وہی مثال ہے اسوہ ہے کہ ہم انہیں اپنا وسیلہ بنائیں اور اسی پر ہم ختم کرنا چاہیں گے کہ خداوندہ فاطمہ کا واسطہ ان کے بابا اور شوہر ان کے اولاد معصومین کا واسطہ کہ ہماری اس عبادت قبول فرما ہمارے گناہوں کو بخش دے ہماری توفیقات میں اضافہ فرما خداوندہ اس دیار میں جہاں چیلنجز مختلف طریقے سے آ رہی ہیں ہماری فیملی لائف میں جو مسائل آ رہے ہیں خداوندہ ہمیں توفیق دے کہ صحیح معنوں میں محمد آل محمد کی سیرت پر ہم عمل کر سکیں صلت و رحمی کے ساتھ ہم اپنی زندگی کو گزاریں قطر و رحمی سے دور رہیں خداوندہ شیعان علی جہاں بھی ان کو اپنے حفظ امان میں رکھ تکفیری افواج کی تمام صلاحیتوں کو نیست و نابود فرما امام کے ظہور میں تعجل فرما ربنا تقبل منا انک انت السمیع العلیم